you have a fork in your workflow and you want to use automation to help you get more done faster, specifically where this fork is involved, where you might take one of two or even more paths, well, that's exactly what we're going to be breaking down in this video. So if that's of interest, stick around and let's get into it. Welcome back to the channel. If you're new here, my name is Gareth. I'm the owner at Gap Consulting, and it's our mission to help you get organized and automated with no-code tools. At the forefront of no-code tools is SmartSuite, one of our favorite database and work management tools. In this video, we're going to be breaking down how you can handle a break or a fork in your workflow where one of multiple paths might be selected and you want to automate the outcome. But before we get into it, I want to invite you first to follow along with me in your own SmartSuite account. If you already have an account, just pop it on open and we can just build alongside together. If you don't already have an account, check out our affiliate link below. Two reasons you might want to do so. Number one, it shows some love back to the channel. Thank you. And number two, if you choose to upgrade to a paid account with SmartSuite, you will be eligible for some exclusive SmartSuite swag that you can't get anywhere else, available only to viewers of our channel. So go ahead and sign up using that link below. Let's hop on into the heart of things and get right into my SmartSuite account. Here I am inside of a very simple solution called Pipeline that I just built, and I have a connection here just to one single application called Leads. Now the idea here is that we are gonna ask some folks for some information, preferably using a form, and we are going to ask for their name and email, and we're also going to want to track and see when this record came into existence. But we have two questions on this form, question one and question two. Now, depending on the answers, we might make one of many different options happen as a next step. So we are going to have an outcome that we determine based on the information that we receive from this prospective client or whoever is filling out the form. Let's actually flip into our form and take a look at what the form looks like. As you'll see, here is the full name field that I mentioned. My email field is included here. Of course, the date created is going to show up automatically based on when they fill out the form. And then we've got two very important questions. Depending on how you answer this, we might choose to move forward or not. We might approve your application or deny it, or we might need more information. And so what are those questions? Do you like creme brulee? Obviously, if the answer here is no, you're not even really human, so we can't move forward. Second question, are the Colorado Avalanche the greatest hockey team of all time? Clearly, also, the answer here should be yes, and if somebody says no, they probably aren't a good fit working with us. So we can go ahead and include these here, and we're using this as some sort of qualification. Now, we are going to make a determination when we receive this information. We could set it up so that this all functioned automatically, but I want to actually demonstrate a semi-automatic process where we're actually coming in and vetting that response. Rather than just sending out a blanketed response automatically, we are going to actually make a determination in terms of what that outcome is. Let's hop on in here and imagine what this might look like if I were to fill this form out myself. I would come in and say, this is my information, here's my email. Obviously, I like creme brulee. Is that even a question? And obviously, the Colorado Avalanche are the greatest hockey team of all time. Submit the form. Now, on the other end of things, we're going to see inside of the actual database that information was received. So here we are. We can see the title of this record is just the full name dash the date created. And then we're looking at the email and we have our answers to the questions here. Now you can see the outcome here was already set to pending. And this is because we have established a default value that basically says when somebody fills this out and we have a new record come into existence, we're not gonna have that question filled out on the form. And so we are going to automatically set this to default to pending. Now what we need to do is make a determination. Are we upgrading them to deny this application? Are we going to approve the application? Or do we have a third case where maybe we need to do some manual follow-up with this prospective client or lead and, you know, take this off of the automation train and instead work with them, you know, one-on-one to get a little more clarity. So we can build here our fork in the road where depending on what is chosen, if it's follow-up, then what are we gonna do? We're gonna reach out manually. If it's denied, we're probably gonna send a nice little denial email that says, thanks, but no thanks. Or if it's approved, we're gonna send through next steps on approval. So how do we do all this? Well, because we are going to tie everything to that outcome field, we can establish automations that are specific to the outcome. So we'll go up to the solution level and drill down into automations and build the first one. Now for this, I really like to use record matching condition because we can get very granular in what these conditions are. So we can say in our leads app, for example, we are looking for that outcome to specifically be equal to approved. If it's approved, this is the automation that's going to run. If it's not approved, we're not going to send this particular automation. We might want to add one more condition here as well where we say, hold on, that email address better exist. Now, this is kind of a fail-safe because in our example, we know that we're going to send an email to this person as next steps in our process. Wherever we can get more granular in our trigger settings, in this example, we're saying email must exist. This is really important because if we don't do this, of course, the next step in our automation is going to fail when we try to send an email to an email that doesn't exist. So any way that you can add better and smarter triggers by adding additional conditions like this, it's only going to help your automations and increase the accuracy of your automated process. Now that our trigger is established, we can move on to the next phase, which is going to be building that action step. And of course, we can send an email through Google, for example, connect to our Gmail account. If we have already set this up, great. If not, we can go through the quick process of linking up to our Gmail, make the selection from the list, make sure that we're getting signed in, and of course, continue in. It's quick and easy. Once we're all set there, we can set up the email so we can send this automatically to the email in the record that we received, and we can say something like approved exclamation mark, and we can bring in some information here like hi and call out the first name here. Let's find that name, drill into the full name field if we want, or add various elements here. Thanks for filling out our form. Your application is approved. And be done with it. Now, once we're happy with the way that this automation is built, whatever those different steps are, we can go ahead and add the automation. Of course, turn it on and do yourself a favor and be sure to name these appropriately. I always fail to do this. Drill into the automation, come up here and just rename it. And we'll call this application approval. Once we're happy with that, again, save the automation and let's go into the next step. We can take the same automation, in fact, duplicate it, but we're going to make some tweaks. And in this case, this will be application denied. Let's go ahead and make the change, duplicate the automation. And of course, we need to make tweaks to the copy. And now we're going to need to set up that the outcome is supposed to be denied in this case. And then we're going to send a different email where we set up denial or some variation of that. And we say, your application is denied or whatever our version of the email is in the case where we are not going to be moving forward. So here we have established a fork in the road of our workflow, of our process. Depending on what we select in the outcome here, one of two actions is going to exist, or we have the third and final option of follow-up, which kind of like a stasis. We are not quite determining yet if we're going to deny or approve the application. And so this would allow us to kind of set things in purgatory while we follow up on this particular application before making a final determination. Now, one thing I do also like to add here is to establish an outcome-filled field. So basically saying that we don't want this automation to perform multiple times. We also don't want for this application to be, let's say, denied at one point, and then maybe it gets upgraded to approved, and we don't want to send multiple emails because that can be confusing. We only want one of these automations to ever trigger, and we want to record when that happened. So in order to do that, let's take this final step of setting up another field here. We can use the yes-no field, and we can set a default to be no. That is to say, we don't want this to be filled out automatically. So we can come on down and say, let's use the yes-no toggle. Yes-no, we'll set our default to be no, meaning that when a new record comes into existence, this will not be filled out to yes. And we will simply say outcome performed. Now, once we're happy with this, let's go ahead and add the field. And of course, by default, this will be no. So what we want to do is add this to the end of every one of our automations that we are updating this outcome performed. That way we can make sure that it only ever happens once. Let's drill in and I'll show you exactly what I mean. Inside of our automations, we first need to add this to our trigger. Because we only want this to trigger once, we want to add the condition that that new field that we built, we called it outcome performed, that must be no. If it is yes, that means we've already sent a response and we don't want to send another one. So now that we've included it here, we need to now add a final action here, and we will update the record that triggered this automation. So we're selecting that here. We're saying we want to update the record from the trigger, and all we want to update is the outcome performed field, and we want to update the field value to yes. Let's go ahead and save that automation. Now, we made this change in our approval automation. We would need to also make these edits in our application denied automation. And what will wind up happening then is when we choose the outcome, in this case approved, it will send the email, and it will also come back in and update our outcome performed field, making sure that we know that we're not going to send out multiple emails. As you can see, that just happened right now. If I drill back into my automations, we can see that that is the fork in the road, the fork in the workflow that was chosen. And if we break down the history here, we're gonna see that it just performed a moment ago and it performed both actions. That is, it sent the email and it updated the record to let us know that it performed the process. I know we went pretty fast here, but there's a lot to unpack in terms of workflow splits and forks in the road, but I hope you got a ton of value. If you did, be sure you've subscribed to this channel so you don't miss future videos like this. And in the meantime, keep on building.